Right, okay, so a question. Did anyone see Richard Scorer on television this week? That's this Savile victim's lawyer on television. Did anyone see him? Okay, well, he was on, I saw him on BBC News this week calling for accountability for failure to report abuse. I've never seen anything like that on the BBC before. But basically, he was calling for the law to be changed to make it an offence not to report abuse. Of course, whether it transpires that this will come into effect is another thing. But anyway, we have the lovely Strider. Strider has been investigating and researching child abuse for the last 4.5 years. She took the Savile case as a blueprint, and she looked into that case, opened the door, went a bit further, opened quite a lot of other doors, and saw how various cases of paedophilia are all linked. So she'll be explaining the grand jury process today. So she's going to give us an overview, and then the wonderful John Hurst will be coming up here and with his encyclopedic knowledge on grand juries and the law in general, and telling us what's going to happen. So there is going to be evidence presented to us and asking the jury whether there is a case to answer. So we're not going to have a guilty or not guilty verdict. We're just presenting the evidence, and then from that, we can then hopefully all use it and maybe all present it to our MPs in various constituencies. Just a suggestion. Anyway, big round of applause for Strider.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you can hear me at the back of the room. I want to first thank you for being here to uphold the legacy of Magna Carta. I'm here to provide you with an overview of the grand jury proceedings. Over the course of today and tomorrow afternoon, we will be considering the issue that the institutions of the state that should be protecting children were not doing so. This short introduction is to briefly explain the program and the process in non-technical terms so that you will know what to expect. Judicial review is the mechanism by which actions of the government and government bodies can be challenged in the courts. It is a means by which ordinary citizens can force public bodies to adhere to the laws to which everyone else is subject. First and foremost, the role of the grand jury is to decide if there is enough evidence for criminal charges to be brought. As a result, it has a lower standard of proof than a criminal trial. The jury is only expected to find probable cause for an indictment, while a trial verdict needs to find a defendant guilty beyond reasonable doubt. Since we are not here to determine guilt, the only evidence that will be presented to you is prosecution evidence. In practice, the evidence presented can be almost anything, from testimony from survivors, witnesses, whistleblowers, documents, video recordings, tape recordings, photographs, or DNA. In our case, because of the circumstances of this grand jury, which we are doing for real, this is not theater. This is how it is happening, and you are a part of it. We have presented our evidence from source documents as screen images. We can provide all the source references for all the evidence that we will present to you today. So for the issue in question, there is no shortage of material, but we've been very selective in our choice of source information. We will not be presenting salacious details, but facts derived both from publicly available official documents and records and first-hand testimony, which you will hear later today. It is therefore possible that some of the information that we will present will be new to you. In presenting the evidence, we have adopted a top-down approach, presenting the macro issues first, and then following through to the more detailed examination of networks and connections. We have not dwelt on any specific case or investigation in relation to survivors or victims. Our focus is more on identifying those culpable. In the interests of transparency, I can make the following disclosures. The evidence has been compiled by an independent, international, culturally diverse, globally located team, most of whom are here, but not all of whom will take the role of prosecutor. None of the evidence gatherers are married to royalty. None of them come from New Zealand, although most of them are dames. There will be three public evidence sessions, two this afternoon, between 1600 and 1745, and one tomorrow afternoon, roughly between 1455 to 1515, depending on overruns on lunch. During these sessions, the prosecutors will present a range of evidence to endeavour to persuade you that the people who will be identified have committed certain crimes. In the introduction session today, from 1530 to 1545, I will outline the scope of the issue and the crime being evidenced. Having heard all the public evidence, you will be invited to nominate yourselves to form a grand jury. This invitation will be extended on Sunday afternoon at about 3:15 by John Hurst, who will be explaining the historical and constitutional background in the next session and will give you chapter and verse. There are certain criteria that must be met in order to be eligible as a juror, although, happily, none of these relate to dress code, as grand jury proceedings tend to be rather more informal. We trust that we will obtain a minimum of 12 grand jurors, who will then retire in private to read witness sworn statements regarding individuals and charges. If the grand jurors decide the evidence creates probable cause to believe the persons named in an indictment committed the crimes, they vote to return the indictment, that is, to charge those persons with the crimes. Voting to return charges is usually known as returning a true bill. If the grand jury votes to return a true bill, the indictment is valid, and it will initiate a criminal case against the people named. A majority of the grand jurors must vote for an indictment in order to return a true bill. If the majority of the grand jurors do not think the prosecutor's evidence creates probable cause, they will vote not to return the indictment. If they vote such in such way, the indictment is not valid and no criminal case results. I would say a simple majority. If that is wrong, I would ask John Hurst.
Sorry, minimum 12.
The jury has to be a minimum of 12, but a majority has to be how many of the 12?
The jury is between 12 and 23. I'll explain shortly, but the verdict is 12.
Okay. I stand corrected. It's a good thing I'm not presenting that. I'm just doing the evidence. Okay. When the grand jurors have reached a decision, John will return here tomorrow afternoon to announce the verdict and outline prosecutions. While the jurors who have nominated themselves retire, there will be an open panel session here for questions and answers and discussion. I leave you with this thought. The legacy of Magna Carta is that the exercise of political power cannot be unrestrained. It must follow the law. I thank you for being the voice of the people. John Hurst will now explain how powerful that voice can be.
I feel quite humble to be here. I apologise for being a policeman to Ian Paddock this morning, but he let me off. I'm attempting to put things right for those who haven't met me before. Some of you believe me. What I'm going to do is give a presentation on whatever happened to grand juries so you understand what happened and how they can be reinstated. Tomorrow I'm going to give a presentation on what I'm going to make use of, the various strategies I'm going to employ to deal with the verdicts in order to make sure they get prosecuted. And I'm also giving a presentation on council tax, and it's called Starve the Beast. Because it's a remedy. Everyone in this room is a British subject, I should imagine. More or less everybody, aren't they? And how many of us know what our powers are? The common law rule is 12 may judge one. So the question was what's a jury verdict? Is 12 may judge one. In order to secure a criminal conviction, the Crown has to convince 24 of a man's peers, 12 in the grand jury and 12 in the petit jury. That's quite a high standard, isn't it? There's no such thing in common law as a majority verdict, and there's no such thing as reducing that number. The last time grand juries were properly invoked is in 1933, so that's a long time ago, isn't it? It's a long time ago. It's three lifetimes. It's beyond living memory, practically, isn't it? Okay. So that's how serious and how important our role is. Michael Benicio has done some research on juries, and they go back to 2500 BC. So if you believe in spirits, shall we say, how many generations of our ancestors are now looking down on us, wanting us to put things right? Yeah, because the abuse that the Crown has got away with since 1933 is having a monopoly on prosecutions. They prosecute who they like, and they ignore who they like, don't they? And the Savile is the classic example, isn't it? Things get reported to the police, and they disappear into this black hole. We aim to put it right, okay? And the reason we can put it right is there are ample constitutional precedents for the power of the individual to form a grand jury spontaneously. You don't have to be invited to court by a sheriff or a judge. You just do it yourself. And if 12 of you get together and hear the evidence and decide there's a case to answer, that's it. That's a grand jury. In America, it's known as a runaway grand jury. For those who want to look online, a runaway grand jury. With that in mind, the way I'm going to present this is my slides are quite detailed, and they've got references at the bottom. I'm assured that there are two cameras looking at the screen. This is going to be filmed, so I can ask you to focus on me, and I'll talk about the slide, and you can look at it at leisure later in detail. Trust me on that. If there isn't a reference at the bottom of the slide, it's me talking. But generally speaking, it's me quoting authorities.
Take photos on your phone as well.
Yeah, there we go. So whatever happened to grand juries? Now, I'm a bit. I normally start my stuff by quoting a few authorities. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, good man, wasn't he? If we allow injustice, we're inflicting injustice on the next generation, and that's against my conscience. We're not going to have that, are we? Winston Churchill, good in parts, wasn't he? Never give in. Yeah, that's not us, is it? Here's the important one. It does not take a majority to prevail, but rather an irate, tireless minority, keeping on setting brush fires of freedom in the minds of men. That's our job, isn't it? And women. He said carefully. During the First World War in 1917, there's an Act of Parliament enforced, Defence of the Realm Act 1915, and the government used the pretext of war to suspend the constitutions. So on the excuse that they'd be consuming manpower, they shut down grand juries. But when you infringe the common law, it doesn't go away. It's just infringed, isn't it? It's like the Theft Act. Somebody in the high street this morning stole a loaf of bread, didn't they? Doesn't mean the Theft Act goes away. It just gets infringed. Magna Carta is traditional race into trial by jury. One persistent error adopted for many centuries and even now hard to spell is the Great Charter guaranteed trial by jury. No, it didn't, because it restated precedent. It restated precedent. So, as I say, Michael Bernicia has researched trial by jury going back to 2500 BC. Our foundation constitution documents, Magna Carta, Declaration of Rights, they restate the common law. Here's a bit of proof. William the Conqueror established the principle in criminal trials should, in the normal case, begin with the indictment of the accused by a represented body of neighbours sworn to speak the truth. Justice should be local. This is me speaking. The authority for the right to be tried by a grand jury is therefore custom, otherwise known as the common law. And think of all those generations of ancestors looking down on us now. They want us to stick to the custom. What's the guarantee of the custom, in theory? It's the coronation oath. Now, you saw the coronation oath that the Queen actually swore this morning, didn't you? And for those that are looking closely, the Archbishop asked the question, will you solemnly promise to swear and govern the people of this kingdom according to the statutes in Parliament agreed on and the laws and customs in the same? Well, in the actual ceremony, she didn't say statutes agreed on, did she? She should have done, because the Coronation Oath Act 1688 specifies it. So there's a major problem there. The Queen hasn't sworn properly. Then there's a signing at the above and the black ribbon or the purple ribbon problem as well. Okay, but the Coronation Oath Act restates the common law, and we expect her to uphold it. And what statutes in Parliament agreed on refers to is the sovereign is bound by the statute as well as the common law. This is one for you to look at later. A lot of people criticise Magna Carta and say it was attained by duress. And it was trained by duress, but in actual fact it was trial by combat, because title to the kingdom is set by battle. Whoever wins, God's on their side. So some people in the freeman community say, well, Magna Carta doesn't apply because it was trained by duress. Yes, it was, but that was lawful because it was king versus king. And the only thing a king inherits when he wins the battle is the job. He doesn't inherit the right to take over the law and change it. And that's the fundamental reason why, for example, the EU is unlawful, because we're taken over by stealth, weren't we, rather than force. But they've got no right to change our law just because they've changed, you know, they've got the job. And there's a reference for the at the bottom for that proposition, Blackstone's commentaries. Okay, so having got away with suspending under the Defence of the Realm Act, which expired in 1920, it was a fixed term Act of Parliament. There's a criminal justice bill in 1925, and the powers that be try and get rid of it then, but there's a parliamentary revolt. Glad to hear it. Unfortunately, they tried again in 1933 and they succeeded. In the debate to abolish the grand jury, the only member of parliament I could find in Hansard to speak up in favour of it, well, against the provision to repeal it, was, suppose it came to pass that we had in this country a fascist government which created a whole mass of new offences, such as holding views disrespectful to the government. In such a case, we'd all be guilty. I mean, in such a case, the grand jury might very well be a constitutional safeguard and prove immense value. So that's only one MP speaks up, or is a member of the Lords, actually speaks up on behaviour. So they didn't know what was going on in 1933. They got it wrong, didn't they? The 1933 Act contains a saving, means an exemption, for the grand jury of the County of London, the County of Middlesex, which still subject summoned to pass on a bill preferred under certain acts relating mainly to treason, certain felonies committed abroad, including offences under the Official Secrets Act. I'm using that exemption to have a national grand jury, because the grand jury of Middlesex is the one that covers the Old Bailey, and the grand jury has the jurisdiction of its home court. Although we're setting ourselves up independently, as I said earlier, we're claiming national jurisdiction because I'm going to be reporting stuff to the Old Bailey. And the wretched act of Parliament that infringed grand jury rights was the Administration of Justice Miscellaneous Provisions Act 1933. So let's see what it actually says. Procedure for indictment. Indictment is an official accusation, it's charge. A person is charged at the police station or charged at the magistrates' court. The case is taken to the Crown Court if it's a jury trial only, a serious matter, and an indictment is signed. Now, it's what the grand jury foreman used to sign, an indictment. Procedure for indictment offenders. You know, I've highlighted an indictment. Subject provision bill, a bill of indictment. An indictment. Be indicted for that offence. Bill of indictment. Become an indictment. And you mentioned indictment, doesn't it? Here we go. Now, here's an Act of Parliament which is still in force. It's casually titled Statute the 5th of 1351, a statute made at Westminster in the Parliament Hall at the Feast of St Hilary in the 25th year of the reign, 1351. So what relevance has this got? Well, here we are, let's have a look. I'd like you to read this one. None should be taken upon suggestion without lawful presentment, nor disenfranchised, but by course of law. Item, where it's contained in the Great Charter of the Franchise of England, Magna Carta, that none should be imprisoned, nor put out of his freehold, nor of his franchises, or free custom, unless it be by the law of the land, is accorded, assented, and established, that from henceforth none should be taken by petition or suggestion made to our Lord the King or his council, unless it be by indictment or presentment of good and lawful people of the same neighbourhood where such deeds be done. We've got a room full of good and lawful people, haven't we? Okay? Incitement, indictment was infringed in legal land by the Act of 1933. Doesn't mention presentment. Presentment remains. So you need to know what a presentment is. Now, I quote authorities. Honourable Mrs. Justice Blackstone, writing in the 1750s, his law books are still authoritative and the courts refer to them. Blackstone Commentaries on the Laws of England, Book the 4th, Chapter the 23rd, of the several modes of prosecution. Several modes. The next steps towards the punishment of offenders is their prosecution or the manner of their formal accusation. And this is either upon a previous finding of the fact by an inquest or grand jury, or without such previous finding. The formal way is either by indictment or presentment. So a grand jury can do two things, presentment or indictment. We need to know what a presentment is, don't we? Presentment, generally taken, is a very comprehensive term, including not only presentments properly so called, but also inquisitions of office and indictments by a grand jury. A presentment, properly speaking, is a notice taken by a grand jury of any offence from their own knowledge or observation, without any bill of indictment laid before them at the suit of the King. So what you do, when you investigate as a grand jury, when you investigate a case, technically speaking, you're a posse, which is Latin for power of the county, and you're investigating a matter off your own initiative. So when you watch the presentations later on about the unfortunate victims of the various miscarriages of justice, you're all potential grand jury members, and I expect you to stay awake and not send text messages, because those are two things jurors aren't supposed to do, and maybe make notes and determine who you think is guilty. And the focus I suggest that you look at is not what happened when the lady was raped 20 years ago. What we're looking at is what happened when she reported it last year. What happened to reported last year? Because what do you think has happened when she reported it last year? Nothing. That's right, yeah. Now, for a policeman, a social worker, or anybody involved in the child protection chain, not to do something is almost certainly an offence of misconduct in office. And the reason it's misconduct in office is, Magna Carta, chapter 40 says, to no one will we delay, deny, or defer right or justice. To no one will we delay, deny, or defer right or justice. We is the royal we. Delay, deny, and defer have their normal meaning. Right has its normal meaning. Justice has a legal definition. Justice is to recognise rights and punish wrongs. Recognise rights and punish wrongs. And where have we heard the word justice referred to earlier today? Twice. It's in the coronation oath, isn't it? The Queen has promised to exercise justice in all her judgments. So for a Crown official to not allow a case to go forward to justice has got to be misconduct in office, hasn't it? And that's the offence I suggest we look at. Okay? It's an indictable offence. It gets a trial by a jury. And it's a serious offence, isn't it? Because potentially it's life imprisonment. So what we're looking for, I suggest, is instances where people have misconducted themselves in office by denying, or deferring rights or justice. And that's what you're looking for evidence of when you hear the presentations. A presentment, properly speaking, is the notice taken by a grand jury of an offence from their own observation. Upon the production of a presentment by a grand jury, the officer of the court must afterwards frame an indictment before the party presented it to the author can be put to answer to it. So if you give me a presentment from a grand jury, I, as a private prosecutor, can go to a court, and the court must put it in front of a petit jury. And that's the difference, isn't it? Because it takes out the policeman, it takes out the CPS, it takes out the social workers, it goes straight from you, the grand jury, to court. And if they argue, we've got a fight, we've got judicial review, we've got misconduct and office charges against those in the food chain that try to stop it. And that's the new insight, isn't it? So grand jury's presentment remains in force, and once you've got a presentment, the Crown must put it in front of a jury. Is that what you've been looking for?
Yeah.
Yeah, excellent, there we are. We're aim to please, don't be Brian. Here's another definition of presentment, just to clarify it. This is from a textbook called Hawke. Presentment in criminal law practice, the written notice taken by a grand jury of any offence from their own knowledge or observation without the Bill of Enlightenment laid before them at the suit of the government. Okay? So the grand jury doesn't have to be called by the sheriff and given the case to deal with. You do it yourself. Originally, the grand jury in criminal proceedings were the informants. They told the King's judges what crimes would be committed in their venue or neighbourhood, as the Saxon word has for it. That's an antecedent. That's a custom. That's what you're doing. Now we talk about persons qualified to be members of a grand jury have an obligation to make investigations into crimes on their own initiative. Now, we were talking this morning about, or just before we started, about the lawyer in the Savile case saying that there should be a duty to report crimes, weren't we? Well, he's not a very old lawyer, because up until 1967 there was a duty to report crimes. It was known as misprision and felony. Misprision is having knowledge of a criminal offence and not reporting to the authorities. And if you didn't and you got found out, you got done for the same offence. It's specifically retained for treason, but it was mainly replaced by two statutory provisions, the Criminal Law Act 1967, sections 3 and 4, which talk about having knowledge of an offence and having knowledge of an offender. But the common law concept of misprision is stronger, and there's a substantial penalty if you know about a crime and don't do something about it. So that lawyer needs educating, doesn't he? We have to seek him out. Qualifications to be a grand juror. They ought to be freeholders, but what amount is uncertain. However, they're usually gentlemen of the best figure in the county, and ladies, because at the time this was written, 1750 Blackstones, ladies didn't sit on juries, but in Saxon earlier times, back to 2500 AD, as I say, ladies did. So you're okay. However, they're usually gentlemen of the best figure in the county. As many as appear on this panel are sworn upon the grand jury to the amount of 12 at the least, and that's because 12 may judge one, to the amount of not more than 23, that 12 may be a majority. So that answers your question, doesn't it? It's 12 to 23, but that's where that comes from. Which number, as well as the constitution itself, we find exactly described as early as the laws of King Ethelred. So in 1750, you knew it went back a long way. Modern Act of Parliament that's in your benefit. Immunity of jurors exercising office. No juror properly impaneled is punishable for, nor will any claim lie against him in respect of anything said or done by him in the discharge of his office. As with laws of England, immunity of jurors, there's a modern act of parliament. You need to know what impaneled means. The arrangements made by the Lord Chancellor include the preparation of lists known as panels of persons assembled by jurors. So I'll do that. So when I ask for volunteers, I'll be compiling a list, so you're covered. Here's going back in time. Here's Blackstone talking. When the grand jury have heard the evidence, if they think a groundless accusation, they use formally to endorse the back of the bill, ignoramus. We know nothing of it. Intimating that though the facts might possibly be true, that truth did not appear to them. But now they assert in English more absolutely, not a true bill. And then the party discharged without a further answer. But a fresh bill may afterwards be preferred by a subsequent grand jury. What's that referring to is the protection against double jeopardy. Because it's not a detailed criminal trial where the rules of evidence apply. You can be put back before the grand jury if some more evidence comes up. If they're satisfied with the truth of the accusation, they then endorse it a true bill. The presentment is said to be found and the party stands presented. But to find a bill, there must be at least 12 of the jury agree. So tender is the law of England of the lives of the subjects, that no man can be convicted at the suit of the king of any capital offence, unless by the unanimous voice of 24 of his equals and neighbours, that is by 12 at least of a grand jury in the first place, assenting to the accusation, and afterwards by the whole petit jury, 12 more, finding him guilty upon his trial. But if the 12 of the grand jury assent, it's a good presentment, although some disagree, so it's a majority verdict. So it's a high standard, 24, isn't it? The burden of proof for the grand jury is the civil standard, balance of probabilities. When sufficient credible evidence has been obtained from members of the jury or witness to substantiate a criminal charge, the jury vote on the matter, and you stop there, no further witnesses are required. Now, one of the abuses that's happened to the grand jury, it still operates in America. You remember the cases where police have killed people, sort of shot and strangled people recently, and they've been acquitted by grand juries. What's happened there is the process of the grand jury has been perverted in that exculpatory evidence from the alleged perpetrator is being allowed in. Okay, what's happening in those cases? And instead of just examining incriminatory evidence, they've been perverted to allow to allow the person accused to give his evidence. And because he's not properly sworn, it's not the higher standard, they've been able to lie with impunity and people have been got off. And of course, that's, you know, the rioting in that American city, Ferguson. That's what the population rose up about. The grand jury came to the wrong conclusion for that reason. Here's a quote from the grand jury handbook. If you go online and search for it, this is Michael Benicia's work. The trial jury hears all the evidence on both sides in an adversarial proceeding under supervision of a trial judge. During the trial, the accused is entitled to be present. This is a petit jury trial. During the trial, the accused is entitled to be present and have the assistance of a counsel. A verdict is rendered only after the accused has had the opportunity to see and hear the witnesses, examine the evidence and have the case argued by counsel. That's a petit jury trial. The trial jury will be charged by the trial judge on the law applicable to the case. The safeguards are designed to protect, preserve the common law rights of an accused. Because that's not quite right, because the jury is entitled to judge the law as well. Now, here's the oath. If you get the job, if you get chosen at random, I name as a grand juror for England and Wales, do solemnly swear or affirm that I will diligently inquire into all matters according to my duty. I will make true presentments of my findings. I will not disclose the nature or substance of the deliberations of the grand jury, the nature of the substance of any testimony other than the evidence or the vote of the grand jury. I shall not make a presentment against a person because of envy, hatred, malice, and I shall not fail to make a presentment against a person because of love, fear, or reward. Traditionally, juries select one of their number to be a foreman. He or she will sign the document to record the verdict, and that's what I'll take to court. And the alternative strategy for putting presentments into effect will be discussed tomorrow. Okay, so once we've got some results, I'll tell you what's going to happen with them. Okay, how am I doing for time?
Yeah.
Beg pardon?
Yeah, another half an hour.
Oh, another half an hour.
No, wait, hang on, that's not...
Any questions about what we said so far? Yeah, gentleman there. Yep. The question is, you're going to talk about judicial review. Can you speak up so everybody can hear? Have we got the walking microphone?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry about that. You both mentioned judicial review. Now, I started the judicial review last year.
Yep.
Against the solicitor for the IPCC because
you spoke about this earlier. Yes.
Yes, she wouldn't pass this to the Jane, whatever her name is at the top, who's got a statutory duty.
Yeah.
So I started that lane, but at that time I knew somebody else was going to a judicial review. This was July last year.
Yeah.
And his barrister told him you've only got a 50% chance of getting through, even though your case is cast iron and solid. He said because the judges have been instructed to refuse 50% of them. Anyway, the case did go through about 2 months later, and the barrister then said, you were very, very lucky because now it's down to 30% against 70.
Yeah. And if they try that trick with us, I will take whoever comes up with this percentage figure to a grand jury and get them indicted. That's the difference.
And then adding on from that, Christopher Grayling, this...
Yeah.
Christopher Grayling is now bringing in conditions which are admittedly he hasn't brought in, but the way he's getting stuff through because he's angry.
Well, we aim to light a fire under these people. We've got away from it for years. There's a judgment about the Bill of Rights, about the suspending power. Just because the Crown has suspended a provision for many years, it doesn't set a precedent and they can't get away with it. Thank so you. we've got an additional tool is the answer, so hopefully that'll work. Anybody else?
Just to say, we've got questions and answers tomorrow, but we do want to bring Strider on, but in your own time to wrap up.
Okay, fine. Right, any more questions?
Can I ask a question?
I can't see where you are. Yeah. Yeah, gentleman there, yeah.
Forgive me for being ignorant.
I've heard you speak on something that I've never really understood before, so please forgive me if I sound stupid, but I've always understood a grand jury to be appointed by some authority. Are you saying that a grand jury can be appointed by an elected group?
They appoint themselves on the authority of Magna Carta, which says that only a jury can try anybody else, and they appoint themselves on the authority of the common law concept of, we've all got a duty to report crimes. That's the difference. The common law duty to report crimes, which we talked about, which is known as misprision, was changed to a statutory duty, and none of you knew about it, did you? So that's right. So because they hide stuff. So trust me on this one. It's a legitimate grand jury if you appoint themselves. It's known as a runaway grand jury, and it goes back to at least 1150 and then further back. And it's protected by the coronation oath. Any gentleman over there? Can you get the microphone?
Yep.
Yeah.
Can you have to tell us what the statutory duty is again, so we can reference it?
It's a common law obligation known as misprision and felony. Misprision and felony.
Misprision.
Misprision. Misprision and felony. And that's concealing an offence.
And the statute?
The statute is the Criminal Law Act 1967, sections 3 and 4.
Thank you.
There we go. I'm not clever, I've got a good memory. My mother and my daughter can do this, okay? But they do it on different subjects. Okay. Any more questions? Gentleman right at the back, yeah?
And you can just start by that. And you wait for the microphone when
you're recording. Get it wrong?
Yeah. Does that mean you can just start one up just like that?
That's right. That's what I'd like you to take away with you.
Yeah.
You've got the power. 12 may judge one at common law. 12 must judge one if they have information about a crime. If you go back to your county and you've researched something and you've got enough evidence, then you're entitled, and in fact, you're required to do something about it, and that includes forming a grand jury.
Spontaneous.
And tomorrow I'm going to talk to you about what you can do with the decision. Okay? You don't need somebody like me. There's a couple of alternatives. Yep.
Why are you always on other sides of the room? Hang on. Again, we are having Q&A tomorrow, so don't feel like...
We're making you run about.
Yeah, I know, just for fun.
A serious question, though it might sound flippant. You've been presenting evidence about how grand juries of England and Wales are impaneled, and indeed that's in the oath.
Yeah.
We're here on the Scots table. We've got three Scots,
the Scots table. Well,
one of whom is even an expatriate without a freehold address in the United Kingdom. So if we wish to serve... does that lessen or even invigorate the case?
My understanding is the Treaty of Union, Article 23 says that rights are to be reciprocally recognised on both sides of the border. And I understand there were some Scots lords at Magna Carta in 1215 as well. So I would suggest it does. Okay, we've got a Scotsman in the room. What do you think, Ed? Microphone, yeah. It's a friend of mine who's researched this, yeah.
We've got some documents from Robert the Bruce that were found in a car boot sale. Professor, amazing documents, all in vellum. Professor Hector McQueen's got them, and it confirms from Robert the Bruce that we have common law in Scotland. And that means that because it's recognised by Robert the Bruce, it's there forever.
That's right, and you've got the Treaty of Arbroath, which is in fact stronger than the Bill of Rights, isn't it?
Yeah, that's what the American Constitution is more based on than Magna Carta. Yeah.
The Treaty of Arbroath specifically says that the people have sovereignty, doesn't it?
Yep.
There we go. Okay, one last question. Gentleman right at the back. Yeah, it's also right at the back.
So I should come running down to you.
So under common law as well, there's the citizen's arrest, isn't there, basically, whereby you witness an offence, you have as much power as a policeman with a warrant card. Can't we start introducing some of these powers into various people?
Where's Roger? No, Roger's gone, isn't he? Who's famous for doing that? Roger at Birkenhead. So yes. Yeah, well, Roger did it at Birkenhead. I've got a document which I've circulated about the private person's power of arrest, but there's no need. And the reason is this. When a policeman wants to investigate a crime, he arrests the person, he takes them and puts them in a little room, and he sits down and asks them questions. But what does he say to them when he arrests them? You don't have to say anything. Okay, so if they've got any sense, what's going to happen? Okay. So the arrest and the interview are not a vital part of the case. If you can accumulate enough evidence to justify an arrest, I would say you've probably got enough evidence to commit to a grand jury. So this is the alternative. So we've moved on from Birkenhead doing it physically, and he was arrested. It's just that he escapes. He was rescued. So we've gone on a stage further to answer your question. It's a slightly bit risky business, a private person's power of arrest. Go back to the Victorian period, and there was a horse-drawn bus in London, and a respectable gentleman sitting on the side of the bus saw a pickpocket put his hand in another man's pocket and made a citizen's arrest. And the constable comes along, and the constable checks what's in the pocket, and the pocket's empty. Okay, so strictly speaking, because it was impossible for the pickpocket to commit an offence because there was nothing in the pocket, there's no crime, so that was an unlawful arrest. If a constable had made that arrest, because a constable can arrest you on suspicion, or otherwise known as by mistake, that'd been okay. So I don't encourage private arrests, and this is what we've worked out to replace them. is the answer to the question. Okay, right, more for me tomorrow. I'll give you a summary of what's going on. You're a jury, stay awake, don't send text messages. And the offence we're looking at is misconduct in office, delay, deny or defer right or justice, contrary to Magna Carta, contrary to the coronation oath, which all Crown officials are bound by. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, John. I challenge anyone to have breakfast with John and just ask him any question with regards to the Constitution. He'll have the answer. It's brilliant. So I'm going to bring Strider back on, and he's just going to wrap things up for us.
Ladies and gentlemen, what you are looking at on screen is the elephant in the room. The obvious problem. I am, in this case, referring to the data relating to child abuse. Those statistics obtained by the NSPCC cover rape, incest, and child prostitution across all 43 police forces in England and Wales in 2011. One child sex attack was reported every 20 minutes in 2011, equivalent to 444 attacks a week. But fewer than 10% of cases ended in a conviction. To collate this data, the NSPCC had to send Freedom of Information requests to each of the 43 police forces because no central record exists. We therefore have no way of directly verifying this data. However, a 2008 Save the Children UK report concluded that sexual exploitation and abuse is chronically underreported, which might indicate that the data gathered by the NSPCC is underreporting the scale of the problem. Please note that South Yorks, number 12 on the map, which includes Rotherham, would rank 15th out of the 43 police areas if one ranks those numbers from highest numbers abused to lowest. In 2012, when this data was actually published, the head of the NSPCC's sexual abuse program said, "The government has to start treating the situation as seriously as it would if faced with an outbreak of chronic disease." 4 years later, it's abundantly clear that the government have remained ineffectual. They haven't even tried to eat the elephant. The headline, the PM dismissive of historic sex abuse claims, could, of course, mean that he is focusing on the present rather than the past. However, the subline is telling. He wants to move on from allegations of sexual abuse involving political figures. Meantime, the public face a deluge of sensationalist headlines and very little forensic evidence or analysis of facts. This introduction is to provide the context for the detailed facts that you will hear, and our starting point is the definition of what constitutes abuse. And our journey starts with the United Nations. We need to define what sexual exploitation and sexual abuse actually means. And this definition is very key in terms of the evidence that you will be hearing. And when I cover this and read it out for you, you will understand why. Oops. As we said, we have technical gremlins. Oh, no, we don't. We're fine. Okay. Sexual exploitation, as defined by the UN, means any actual or attempted abuse of a position of vulnerability, differential power, or trust for sexual purposes, including, and this is key, but not limited to, profiting monetarily, socially, or politically from the sexual exploitation of another. The term sexual abuse means the actual or threatened physical intrusion of a sexual nature, whether by force or unequal or coercive conditions. And I want you to bear in mind those words, vulnerability, differential power, trust, profiting monetarily, socially, and politically. The UN banner that you see on the screen mentions the words UN and related personnel. The related personnel includes the Children's Commissioners, whose role is to promote implementation of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. And you might be asking, who are these people? And I would just like to explain the context. The role of the Office of Children's Commissioner for Wales was created in 2001 in response to recommendations by Sir Ronald Waterhouse. In his report of his inquiry into abuse in children's homes in North Wales, which he poignantly named Lost in Care, which was published in 2000, he created this role. As a result of the Children's Act in 2004, the post of Office of Children's Commissioner for England was created, and now there are four of these, one each for England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. The Children and Families Act of 2014 changed their primary function from representing the views and interests of children and young people to promoting and protecting children's rights as defined and determined by the UN. Now, Maggie Atkinson, who is soon to be replaced, is OCC England. Her credentials are that she obtained a teaching qualification in English, history, and drama, is a member of Common Purpose, and although appointed Children's Commissioner for England in 2010, she was initially rejected by the Education Select Committee, but Ed Balls overruled that decision. Keith Towler, seen as Superman on the right, and this is from Sight for Children, has a degree in fine art from Exeter College of Art and Design and is chair of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child for Wales. And the reason that I think they are pertinent. Tim Loughton, MP, in his open letter to David Cameron on the 8th of November 2012, called for an overarching inquiry into child abuse, saying there was clearly a role for the Children's Commissioners. He also wrote, "Organised sexual exploitation has been manifesting itself in recent years, evidenced in Rochdale, Derby, and elsewhere, and there are many more deeply shocking cases still to come." And he wrote that in 2012. He also said, the public will now wonder what has actually changed since Savile or North Wales. Curiously, the Children's Commissioners have been noticeable by the absence of their voices in the public coverage of child abuse, and this is very surprising. Because in 2011, in fact, in October 2011, they organised their own inquiry into child sexual abuse. This was at the behest of Michael Gove, who was prompted by the convictions in Rochdale. He asked for an accelerated report, and in consequence, and I quote from the report that was produced, the evidence was partial. The terms of reference, and we will talk more about these later, of this particular CSA inquiry was to promote children's rights with a special focus on children in care. Now, since the OCC report to the Department of Education, and that's the Right Honourable Michael Gove, Their findings were submitted to him, and an extract from the report includes the following information. Glasses on. The NSPCC's study of child maltreatment demonstrated that 34% of children who were sexually abused by an adult did not tell anyone about it. In other words, the graph, the numbers that you saw from the NSPCC graph on the first part of the presentation could at least be understated by 34%. What disturbs me, and I hope disturbs you, is that the reliance on NSPCC data, the NSPCC, a charity, 90% funded by the public, and also in the House of Lords, the observation that the Office of Children's Commissioner has been constrained by an unnecessarily close working relationship with the Department for Education. I want to share some more data from that report. Michael Gove's big society is apparently so vast that many children are lost in care, as indicated in the bar chart shown. Before I explain the data, a few clarifying statements. The majority of data gathered in respect of the missing children emanates from local authority residential care homes, not independent care homes. Missing incidents are inconsistently reported across locations, and on average, 45% of children in care live in care homes outside of the local authority, which has primary responsibility for them. And I want to share this data with you, and I hope you're as shocked as I was. The bar chart shown represents 306 children, all from location A. 61 are missing. 6 are not. 10 are status unknown. And 229 are labelled no data. That's 74% of the children in location A. This may help shed a little light on that data. This data is not directly related to the OCC inquiry, but in the aftermath of a search for 114 missing files in connection with the Dickens dossiers, of which there were actually 5, and they included a 1 million signature petition, the government released a 37-page file which reveals the exact number of files on child abuse evidence that was either lost or destroyed during the period 79 to 99. 2,074 files were destroyed. 81% of case files on abused children were destroyed. All of this points to massive government failings, which are echoed in the headlines. In particular, we have to mention Rotherham and Barnardo's, a charity, in their independent review of the Rotherham Safeguarding Children Board, commended them for their transparency, their openness, and their honesty in December 2013. And then in 2015, they tweeted, "We need to know how people in key places got away with abusing children for so long. It's staggering." And indeed, the hypocrisy is staggering. The blurring of boundaries between people, professions, public and private sectors, covered in the article, The Rotherham Common Purpose Effect, is a microcosm of a national problem. The National Crime Agency is now investigating Rotherham for systematic, or the councillors of Rotherham, for systematically withholding the truth with a view to charging them with misconduct. And that's the way we have chosen to present our evidence. I know John has covered this, but as a reminder, misconduct is committed when a public officer acting as such willfully neglects to perform his duty and/or willfully misconducts himself to such a degree as to amount to an abuse of the public's trust in the office holder without reasonable excuse or justification. And misconduct is the charge that we have chosen to evidence to you in the sessions today and tomorrow afternoon. And I would add, there is no such thing as accidental failure. All failure is at least half imposed. And where does the responsibility lie? Just a small schematic to indicate those whom we will be investigating and where we are pointing the finger. Now, originally, our plan was that you would have a break to consider that overview before you delved in to a full evidence session. Unfortunately for you, I'm afraid you have to put up with me just a tad longer. I will advance the slides, and we'll see. Theresa May, a name or a statement of ambiguous intent. When interviewed on the Andrew Marr show, Theresa May claimed to be ignorant of how state institutions failed to protect children. But we have an answer to that question. Our investigations show a very clear pattern of repeat behavior designed to ensure a cover-up of child abuse and child exploitation. We will show you both how it was possible and who stands accountable. The mainstream media continually emphasize that the abuse is historic, and we are indebted to their guidance, since going back in time provides the platform for us to illustrate that history repeats itself. And to evidence this, we are now going to step back to the mid-1990s and the Waterhouse Tribunal, which was set up to investigate child abuse in North Wales. How was it possible? Modus operandi one, deferred investigations. Prior to the Waterhouse Tribunal, there were a number of investigations into widespread child abuse within the institutions in Wales. The Gillings report, which I will explain shortly, was the 14th report into Clwyd Children's Homes. 12 internal council reports were prepared at various times on individual homes as well as investigating other abuse allegations. At the centre of the North Wales inquiries was Bryn Estyn in Wrexham, which was one of the two main local authority homes. It comprised an assessment facility, a remand home, and long-term residential care for between 40 and 60 boys. As a remand home, it fell under the auspices of the Home Office until 1973. Prior to the Cartref inquiry, abuse allegations in Clwyd led to the convictions of Stephen Norris in 1990 for abuse at the community home, and also another high-profile case in 1991 involving Frederick Rutter, a former police officer. The Cartref panel of inquiry, which delivered its report a year later in 1992, established that a paedophile link between suspects and convicted offenders was that at some stage in their careers, they had all worked at Brynestyn. This connection also dovetailed with other allegations against a suspected abuser, who was also an employee, an ex-employee of Brynestyn. This information was passed to the police in July 91, and an investigation was initiated in August of the same year. Further allegations were forthcoming, including retired and serving police officers. In March of 93, files on these officers were submitted to the Crown Prosecution Service, who advised against taking it further. The Gillings two-year inquiry had uncovered an appalling and extensive history of child abuse, including buggery, assault, and cruelty, dating back at least two decades, and culminating with a series of paedophile trials covering Brynestyn. All of these official inquiries and investigations proved conclusively that wide-scale abuse was occurring and had been occurring over decades. Yet it took well over 6 years of reports and whistleblower campaigning for the government to announce a full-scale inquiry, which William Hague did in his capacity as Secretary of State for Wales in 1996. How could this happen? How could it take so long? Well, part of the reason rests with what we have called the missing dossiers strategy. Because not one of those 14 reports, including Gillings or Cartreff, was ever made public. Shall we go on to the next template? Information withheld or lost. The Cartreff inquiry was chaired by John F. Banham, a retired senior officer of Cheshire Social Services. Interestingly, the Clwyd Area Child Protection Committee elected to set up parallel inquiries with the Education Department and the Health Authority. The three inquiries were all completed in June of 91. After a panel review of these inquiries, Clwyd County Solicitor discussed with their insurers, Municipal Mutual Insurance, and the Crown Prosecution Service, the extent to which the report could be published. The outcome, a year and a half later, in October of 92, was that there would be no debate on matters that might be subject of criminal proceedings, and significantly, that might generate claims against Clwyd. In other words, the reports were scotched. In the 1996 inquiry by John Gillings, that was shelved due to fears that there would be compensation claims, and so copies were ordered to be pulped. I guess that was the predecessor to shredding. Pirate copies of the report, seen by only a few people, were protected for years. Child abuse whistleblower and ex-Duncroft girl, Andrea Davison, had a copy, which was seized by the Derby and North Wales Police in January 2010. Former Minister MP Rod Riches said he had seen it, and the report named Peter Morrison as a child abuser. Sir Peter Hugh Morrison, PC, was a British Conservative politician MP for Chester from 1974 to 1992, and Parliamentary Private Secretary to Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher. PC, in this case, stands for Privy Council. When Clwyd decided not to publish the Gillings report, it passed it on, complete with a recommendation for a judicial review, to William Hague, the Secretary of State for Wales. The 300-page Gillings report was eventually published following an FOI request by the BBC. There's irony. A heavily redacted version of Gillings was released on the 8th of July 2013 by Wrexham County Borough Council, 17 years after it was first produced. There's two points to note here. The pirate copies appear to be typed in a different font to that of the recently released redacted versions. And the redacted version was perhaps not as informative as the original. One of the key elements of this manipulation of any investigation rests with what should be coming up on the next slide, the terms of reference. Let me zoom that for you. Oh, good. The Waterhouse Tribunal terms of reference were proposed by officials in the Welsh Office and agreed by ministers and widely supported by Parliament. The impact, I'm giving you just a moment to focus on the screen, the impact of this was that many allegations were not fully investigated. Since the responsibility for approved schools and remand homes was not transferred from the Home Office to the Secretary of State for Wales until 1973, setting the Waterhouse terms of reference from 1974, of course, meant that the Home Office would never suffer scrutiny. The remit prevented investigation into abuse outside two specific areas. This, in turn, curtailed investigation into staff who had links with other care homes, and this was already known. Networks of related abusers remained uninvestigated, and this omission will be examined in more detail later in the evidence sessions. Earlier reports had shown that abuse was widespread and was not confined to care home premises. Children were trafficked outside of those homes. And most controversially, excluding scrutiny of decisions whether to prosecute named individuals means that Peter Morrison, amongst others, who had already been named, got off scot free. How else do they manage this? How else is it possible? The control of key personnel. William Hague chose Sir Ronald Waterhouse as chair of the tribunal. And this fact is confirmed by Ronald Waterhouse himself, who, in response to an opening question from Nick Booth, the barrister, for one of the groups of former residents in care homes who made an application about masonry, said, "The members of the tribunal are in this position. The tribunal was set up by Parliament, and the members of it were appointed by the Secretary of State for Wales. And the criticism of the composition should be addressed through the proper channels." I think he was directing us to whom we should address our concerns. Waterhouse kept handwritten notes throughout, and at the end of each day produced a meticulously detailed resume, of the evidence, which he eventually incorporated into his report, Lost in Care, which took him a year to write and ran, allegedly, to more than 1,000 pages. The online public version of Lost in Care numbers 893 pages. Did Waterhouse do a good job? Well, you'll probably have to hear a little more of the evidence to understand whether that was the case, and you'll have to bear with me because technically this could go wrong. Right. Let's try.
Des Frost is a haunted man. 30 years ago, he says he went to the police to warn them of allegations of child abuse in North Wales. Then he was deputy director of the Bryn Allen Children's Home near Wrexham. In 1995, its owner, John Allen, was jailed for 6 years for sexually abusing the children in his care. But we can reveal that more than 10 years earlier, Des Frost says he was concerned about his boss.
I was approached by a member of staff who told me briefly of some rumours that were going around the organisation. And he told me some pretty hairy stories about allegations of child abuse by John. I then decided to go to the police on behalf of myself and the rest of the staff, because it was a difficult situation, but I didn't want it ever said, why didn't you do anything about it?
He went to the police in Chester, where he lived, and asked them to contact police in Wrexham. Des Frost's interview was recorded in 1997, but ITV Wales was prevented from broadcasting it because of a threat of legal action by the North Wales Child Abuse Tribunal.
A couple of days before transmission, officials at the tribunal found out that Des Frost had been interviewed. They put pressure on the programme to remove any new allegations that Des Frost was making. The threat was contempt proceedings, which could have meant that some journalists went to prison. In the end, the allegations were removed, especially because we were certain that Des Frost was bound to be called as a witness before the tribunal.
Des Frost, too, thought he would be called as a witness to give his evidence before it. He says he told tribunal staff he was willing to appear, but he was never called.
I honestly thought I would be called, and I wasn't. And that really was something that I didn't understand.
This is Lost in Care, the Waterhouse report that's now itself being investigated by a judge. One of its key conclusions was that North Wales Police could not be criticised for the way it handled allegations of abuse. Des Frost's evidence suggests that conclusion can now be questioned, and that there may have been missed opportunities by the police to stop the abuse a decade earlier.
I think that might give an indication of how whistleblowers and survivors are treated. There is more than one reference, surprisingly, to paedophile rings in the Waterhouse report. I quote, "Again, it must be said that we have not received any criticisms of these individual investigations, save for a submission that the further investigation of Gary Cook and possibly the investigations of Murig Jones and Gillison and Jerry should have been wider because of the alleged existence of a paedophile ring. And during the period under review, there was a paedophile ring in the Wrexham and Chester areas in the sense that there were a number of male persons, many of them known to one another, who were engaged in paedophile activities and were targeting young males in their middle teens. The evidence does not establish that they were solely or mainly interested in persons in care, but such youngsters were particularly vulnerable to their approaches. I would remind you that Sir Peter Morrison was MP for Chester and was named in the Gillings report. Waterhouse also made particular reference to the Chester branch of the Campaign for Homosexual Equality, some members of which, he wrote, saw it as a useful agency for identifying and contacting potential victims. Following the publication of the Lost in Care report, on the 16th of February 2000, BBC Wales rapidly announced that future further prosecutions were unlikely. Deputy Chief Constable of North Wales Police, John Owen, welcomed the Waterhouse inquiry's findings and said its evidence would not form the basis of further political investigations. The evidence had already been considered by the Crown Prosecution Service, and the publication of this report does not of itself prove or provide additional evidence to merit further prosecutions, he said. To help you determine whether the handling of the Waterhouse Tribunal was fit for purpose and for whom, we're going to fast forward now to 2012. We're going to skillfully evade any mention of Elm Guest House. and the cover-ups of that scandal in 1982, and then again in 1990, and then again present day. What is happening here? Apart from the fact it's the wrong slide. So we'll just move on. When we ask whether Waterhouse was fit for purpose, you must understand that the Waterhouse Tribunal report is now the subject of two separate investigations, which were launched in November 2012, pretty much the same date as Tim Loughton wrote to David Cameron, suggesting that there be an overarching inquiry. So we have first the independent McCure review, which was established on the 8th of November 2012, to examine the conduct and remit of Sir Ronald Waterhouse's inquiry. It is chaired by Dame Julia Wendy McCure, to whom we offer belated congratulations for her timely elevation in November 2012 to the Privy Council. McCure issued a paper published on the January the 8th of 2013 inviting submissions from people with an interest in the issues it outlined. Two submissions were from Andrea Davison and Brynell and Victims. An extract from Andrea Davison's submission is on the screen. Let me read it. I am aware that the following parliamentarians knew about the elite paedophile ring and the cover-up. And she names Willie Whitelaw, John Major, Ken Livingstone, Edwina Curry, David Waddington, Michael Howard, Margaret Thatcher, Leon Britton, Ken Clark, Tony Blair, Gordon Brown, Jeffrey Dickens, who was the whistleblower, Alan Michael, Rod Richards, John Merrick, and William Hague. Later, you're going to be hearing first-hand experience of the North Wales State Care experience. Now, nearly 2.5 years later, the review, which Justice McCure promised would be quick and meticulous, has gone strangely silent. The official website hasn't been updated since June of 2013. No reasons are given. No time is given for submission to government, nor any idea of the publication date. FOI requests for updates remain unanswered. That's information withheld. And why would they withhold that information? The answer is what you see on screen. It's a lame duck. It's a dead-end investigation. It's a devil and deep blue sea situation. If McCure concludes that the Waterhouse terms of reference were too narrow, then William Hague stands accountable. If McCure concludes the terms of reference were appropriate, the lack of convictions and follow-up simply validates that this was a massive cover-up. And MPs from all parties are implicated. So just recall the UN definition of sexual exploitation. Actual or attempted abuse, positions of vulnerability, not limited to profiting monetarily, socially, or politically. This is dirty politics. Now, what of this secondary investigation of Waterhouse? We have Operation Pearl. Now, that was begun a week later, November the 15th, 2012. This is led by Keith Bristow. He is Director General of the National Crime Agency, and his brief is to re-examine the allegations of historic abuse in North Wales and the original police investigations. Now, Bristow is not a PC, as in Privy Council, he's rather a CP, as in common purpose. Well, the terms of reference are interesting. I'm not sure that I have those on the slide, so I'll read. We have, we are going to assess any information. We are going to review the historic police investigations. And we are going to deliver the terms of reference. And if the need is identified, we might investigate those allegations where necessary. We shouldn't denigrate, actually. Operation Palliel has achieved some results, unlike many other investigations. Firstly, we have an admission that many abusers have evaded justice. The reason? The survivors were ignored and fobbed off, and the abusers died of old age before an investigation was undertaken. Secondly, we have a complete exoneration of the North Wales Police. This was obviously a very efficient investigation, as it was completed within 5 months. Since this extract comes from the Palliel report, the interim report of April 2013. Now, the dates that they mention here are rather interesting, because they say they have identified 120 potential suspects. Predatory sex attacks against vulnerable youngsters between 1953 and 1995. I.e., quite a long time before the terms of reference that Sir William Hague set for the Waterhouse Tribunal. But we have a crowning achievement. This merits some attention. Palliel have convicted a known serial abuser. John Allen. Waterhouse has this to say in his report in respect of John Allen. When John Allen was tried early in 95, he was not charged with any offence of buggery, but we have heard evidence from three witnesses who alleged that they were buggered by him, and another who said that he attempted to do so on 4 occasions. The fairest judgment that we can make upon this matter is that there is now credible evidence that Allen's offences went beyond indecent assaults on some occasions, but that we cannot make a more decisive finding, bearing in mind the procedural limitations of an inquiry like this. John Allen, 73, of Needham Market, Suffolk, who had denied 40 counts of sex abuse against 19 boys and one girl in the late 1960s up to the early 1990s, was convicted at Mould Crown Court after being convicted of 33 charges. Now, whilst the police were, and are, seemingly unable to unearth the paedophile network, our evidence gatherers have been rather more successful. Now, this information will be forthcoming in the next sessions. And where are we today? Well, we have a child abuse inquiry and police investigations. And I'm going to run through this quite quickly because I know that we're relatively tight on time. What I'd like you to do as potential members of our grand jury is to match the statements and the information to the categories that I hope you can see on screen. So, where do we start? On the 7th of July 2014, Theresa May announced the independent panel inquiry into child sexual abuse, which was set up to consider, note the terms of reference, whether public bodies and other non-state institutions have taken seriously their duty of care. And we have seen evidence that that cannot possibly be the case. Let us review progress. Late 2012, following Tom Watson's claim in the House of Commons that there had been a cover-up of Westminster paedophiles, a scoping exercise known as Operation Fairbank was launched to establish if there were sufficient evidence for a formal inquiry. A number of police operations have spawned from this. However, prosecutions are very few, other than a handful of television celebrities. Elsewhere, abuse allegations against the late MP Cyril Smith are aired in Parliament by Rochdale MP Simon Dansuk. Greater Manchester Police say he should have been prosecuted. January 2013, police launch Operation Fernbridge to investigate allegations about a paedophile network linked to Parliament and Number 10, centred on Elm Guest House in Barnes, southwest London. February 2013, we have the Dickens dossier drama. Mark Sedwill, the most senior Home Office civil servant, launches an independent review of more than 746,000 files from 1979 to 99 that were passed to the Home Office to identify any information received about organised child abuse and the outcome of any action taken. He draws a blank, though he does disclose that 114 files are missing. 4th of July 2014, Prime Minister David Cameron orders Mr. Sedwill to look again at the handling of the 2013 Home Office review. These investigations are now known colloquially as the Wittam reviews. And then we have, on the 8th of July 2014, Butler Sloss is announced as the chair of the inquiry. And a week later, on the 14th of July, Baroness Butler Sloss stands down as the head of the independent inquiry. She faced calls to quit because her late brother, Sir Michael Havers, was Attorney General in the 1980s, and he attempted to cover up Sir Peter Hayman's paedophilia, and he's also been implicated as an abuser himself. In October 2014, Lord Mayor of London, Fiona Wolfe, was named the new head of the inquiry. She resigned, having been named the head of the inquiry on the 5th of September. She lasted just a little longer. Some victims and representatives called for her resignation after she disclosed she had five dinners with Lord Britton from 2008 to 2012. Now, those are not the only reasons I've summarised. She's also one of his neighbours, or was. Baron Spennythorne, that's Leon Britton, stands accused of abuse at Elm Guest House, and as Home Secretary in Thatcher's government, of not dealing appropriately with the Dickens dossiers on Pye paedophiles. Then we have November 2014. We have a review by the NSPCC. Chief Executive Peter Wanless, and I know there'll be some people in this room that will sit up at the name. He said it was impossible to say whether files were removed to cover up abuse, but found nothing to support such concerns. He also found no evidence that the paedophile information exchange, known as Pye, was funded by the Home Office. 21st of January 2015, Lord Britton dies, allegedly, after a long battle with cancer. He joins a long list of alleged abusers who were either not questioned or demised just before their trials. How unfortunate. On the same day, a university lecturer unearths a previously top secret file held at the National Archives, which purportedly contains allegations of unnatural sexual behaviour by establishment figures in the 1980s. Talk about timing. On the 4th of February 2014, New Zealand Judge Lowell Goddard is named by the Home Secretary as the new head of the inquiry. Although May pledged to consult with survivors, Goddard was nominated by Ben Emerson, QC, who controversially assisted Fiona Wolfe in downplaying her links with Leon Britton, and who also stands accused of bullying and gagging the inquiry panel members. Of course, they've all been fired, but he hasn't. So, where are we now? I managed to pull this off the website, but it's a couple of days old, so I doubt much will have changed since then. An update on the inquiry official government website, posted on the 23rd of February. The inquiry is in transition as we prepare for a new chair and panel to take up their roles. Changes will be made to this website over the next few weeks, but anyone wishing to contact the inquiry can still do so through the contacts page. A new website is also being constructed. Why? To get rid of incriminating information that they posted up there in the first place, where they withheld information and lied about the connections. So that's the template. That's what I want you to think about. Now, I'm going to ask for guidance here, because I have another presentation that follows on from this. And I'm wondering, they must be tired of listening to me. Are you sure? Are you happy for me to continue? Can you bear it? Yeah. This is a lot of information. It's a lot of information. Yes, we're going to have a consultation about how long this will take. I'm going to be... Sorry, change plan. If Kaz is here, because a lot of her evidence is first-hand, she's here, I think it will dovetail better with what you've heard for you to hear this.
Right. This is approximately half of the children's homes in the UK where abuse has taken place. Half. I'm still trying to compile the map. As you can understand, it's extremely harrowing work. Having been in care and realised nobody needs that much care, I spent 22 years carefully boxing up and packing away all the demons in my head, putting them in a little secure room right in the back of my head, locking all the doors on my way out so nothing could escape. And then David Cameron opened up a whole new inquiry into North Wales. He says, yeah, all right, maybe Watt Rouse didn't do a good job. Well, we all knew that to start off with. We all knew it was a whitewash because nothing was done. Nothing changed. And all the demons started clamouring to get out. I thought, well, fuck this. And I did what I do best. When the shit hits the fan, I buried my nose in research. And I found one hell of a lot of shit. I thought, okay, maybe my life wasn't so bad when I was raped and impregnated and then, like, thrown on the streets. You know, maybe my life wasn't so bad. Because at least I survived. Not all of them did. Quite a lot never came through it. Some of them still live with it day in, day out, and will never come through it. Now, this is the start of the main focus of abuse, of the main focus of paedophile information exchange, the Wirral. Started at Greystone Heath, as most things seem to start in the Wirral. I've lost where I am now. Yeah, I have lost where I am. Serves me right. Stayed on. That is Greystone Heath. Yeah. 21-year-old student Keith Laverack started working there, and over the course of a few years, he embarked on a course of buggery and indecent assault on at least 16 boys, which he shared with various colleagues and friends. Brian Percival, the storeman of the home, he was convicted for God knows how many abuses. Alan Langshaw, 24 boys. Roy Shuttleworth, 10. Jack Bennett, 2. Stephen Norris, they lost count. Grain and Shuttleworth were both promoted to other homes in Warrington. Terence Hoskins, who had done that same as Percival. He went off to St. Aidan's in Widnes, and he had a fondness of using cane on boys, thrashing them, and then pushing it into the backsides. He abused boys there with the housemaster, Colin Dick. Following a complaint, Colin Dick was accused of indecent assault, and he was acquitted, as they usually are. Hoskins went on to become president of National Children's Home, which is now Action for Children. And he then wrote a reference for Colin Dick, effectively stating that he was no longer a risk to children and recommending him for a post in Manchester as a residential social worker. Colin Dick was then allowed to go on and abuse boys for another 8 years. In 81, Dennis Grain and Hoskins were back working in Doncaster at Hesley Hall, Hesley Hall Group. And then Dennis Grain went on to Eton and worked there for a couple of decades, whilst Prince William was in attendance, actually. Oops. You know, let's keep it all in the club together. You know, Prince William. Yeah, go on. You know, at least he was primed by his parents. Alan Lanshaw was jailed for 10 years in 94 for 30 counts of serious sexual assaults and indecent assaults against boys under 16 at homes in Cheshire and Liverpool. However, first accusations were made in 86, with this woman being right at the centre of it, Miss Edwina Curry. She was responsible for the childcare system at that point, and she was asked to intervene on Langshaw's behalf, which she did. He went on to get another job in residential childcare, because she said, well, he's an upstanding upright man. He couldn't do anything like that. I believe in him fully. Well, I'm sorry, I've heard that about Jimmy Savile from her as well, haven't I? You know, she's not exactly the best judge of character. When asked about Jimmy Savile and why he'd been given the keys, she said, well, if it meant we could break the strike and help the patients, then the ends justify the means, doesn't it? If she was asked about the mentally ill patients that he'd abused, she says, if I'd have known, I would have asked him, Jimmy, give me the keys, and it would have stopped. Yeah, would it? Would it really, love? She was very open when she admitted she knew Morrison had sex with the 16-year-old boys when the age of consent was 21, and that he had been protected by a culture of sniggering. In her diaries, she called him a noted pederast, the liking for young boys. She put in her diaries, Peter Morrison has become the PM's PPS, personal public secretary. He's what they call a noted pederast, with a liking for young boys. He admitted as much to Norman Tebbit when he became deputy chairman of the party. But then she added, however, I'm very discreet, and so must he be. She also went on to give Jimmy Savile the keys, as we know, for Broadmoor, an unqualified paedophile DJ, and not a very good one at that, an hospital porter, and a known friend of Peter Sutcliffe, one of the inmates of Broadmoor. You know, what's he going to do? Let his mate out for days out? Norman Tebbit had a little choice in admitting that he knew Peter Morrison was a paedophile when Edwina Curry outed the fact that he knew it. You know, talk about giving your mate no recourse for escape. Now, when Stanton started working at St. Vincent's in the Wirral, Roy Shuttleworth had recommended him for the job. Roy was working at Greystone. but they'd both met each other when they were on a childcare course, a residential childcare course in Birmingham. That residential course was taught by Peter Wrighton. He groomed the whole social work profession for over a decade. He had Tavistock, National Children's Homes, Barnardo's, Mind, all listening, all advising, all recommending him as the person that was right to lead childcare. They set up a steering committee to run his group, and we have quite a few people in on that, including Claire Rayner, the agony aunt. Now, one of the guys who was on the course, Rod Ryle, the ex-director of Calderdale Social Services, convicted in 1988 for crimes against two boys in care. Committee who appointed him as director of social services weren't told of a previous incident involving the same two boys, and they appointed him. When he was appointed as director, he took over a project to set up a new assessment centre in Calderdale, Skirkett Lodge, and he got one of his friends from Birmingham, set him as principal, Malcolm Phillips, who was also convicted in 2001. When Ryle was first arrested in 88, they found him living in the private flat that Malcolm Phillips had at Skirkett Lodge. He'd been there for over 2 weeks. Phillips, knowing the guy was a wanted man, had let him live within the children's home, knowing that he was wanted for crimes against children, giving him full access to more children. And this guy called himself a child carer, a social worker that was there to protect children. I'm sorry, that doesn't compute with me. You don't put children at risk and still care about them. You don't harm children and still care. You can't. Otherwise, you wouldn't be hurting them. You wouldn't be putting them in that situation. Now, as head of assessment centre, Malcolm Phillips had final say in any child leaving the borough. He used, what we know so far, 5 different units. Newton Aycliffe, secure. St William's in Market Weighton, which took boys only and was run by De La Salle Order of Roman Catholic Church. Bryn Estyn, which had secure until it shut down in the mid-80s. Bryn Allen, he only sent girls to Bryn Allen community. We know of 10 that were sent over the 20-year period. All were between 12, 15, blonde-haired, blue-eyed. And then he sent them to Macclesfield Young Persons Unit. Now, Dr. Peter Wells, fantastic man, cannot say a thing wrong about him. Yeah? Absolutely love the guy. He ran Macclesfield Young Persons Unit, which is Mental Institute for Children. It was attached to Parkside Mental Hospital in Macclesfield. It shut down in 92. He did his best to help disturbed children, abused children. When he closed the facility after funding ran out, he transported all the files, all the records of all the children for the last 15 years that he'd been running the facility over to Parkside, the main unit, put them all in the catacombs of Parkside. He made several trips with the car to fill a room with boxes. When Parkside shut down in 95-96, one box was found of files for Macclesfield Young Persons Unit and passed to the archives. One. When I spoke with him last year, he told me there were at least 25 boxes went into storage. Down to one? What the fuck? No known complaints of abuse have ever been heard about Macclesfield Young Persons Unit. And that is the only place I felt safe as a child, in the nut house, as a 14-year-old kid. Now that is sad. Sorry, but it is. Now, Duncroft, oh, well, we all love Duncroft, don't we? Every year, two girls would be taken by a Cambridge professor up to Brancaster in Norfolk by Professor Bell. But they would have an overnight stop first in Cambridge at Professor Bell's house. Nobody knew why, but they always went in pairs and they never left each other alone. When my mum landed in Duncroft in 67, she was told by the girls, you don't go off, if you're taken on camp, you don't go off on your own. You go with another lass. You stay together. You look after each other. Okay, she says, fair enough. They would do overnight in his house and then be taken for a shopping trip in King's Lynn before they then went on to Brancaster to meet up with all the other girls from different units. Now, in Duncroft, they had the main home and then they had a hostel for girls moving on. You know, older, too old for school, but not quite old enough to be kicked out. The rules were nobody can go out in the evening without a male escort. One woman was set up with a man about the same age as her, and within weeks she'd been raped, impregnated, and forced into a marriage. Over the next 6 years, she was raped several more times, had three more children, and then finally escaped him and ran. Didn't know what happened to the children until a few years later when one of them got in touch and said, right, you left us all there to be raped by my dad. Now I want you to stand up in court and say he's a good man. What? He's raped the kids as well, but I want you to stand up in court and say he's a good man. What? Well, you married him. Didn't have much choice about it. But you married him. Well, I was forced into it, she says. Well, that's not my fault, says the kid. Well, it's not fucking mine either, says the mum. And that was it, contact was broken. There was no more contact between the families. Yes? Because they were, I can only put it down as, yeah, that's the one. Just, you know, who knows why? Yeah, who knows why? Because you get that indoctrinated to it, you expect everyone to stick up for the person that you believe loves you. You believe gives you all this attention because they love you, not just because they're a dirty old bastard. So yeah, contact broke there. One of the girls ended up dying in a mental institution herself. She was 24 when she died. She'd been left with the mental age of a two-year-old. When she had whooping cough vaccinations. She was put into the mental home at 16 when her father had had enough of using her. And his other daughters had had children for him to play with. So he got rid of his youngest kid. Right, this is the nursery that was set up when Brynallen Community closed. It was set up on the property of Brynallen Hall. It ran for 13 years. As you can see by the symbol, it's a bit blurred there. But the phone number starts, the mobile phone starts 04. In 99, all mobile numbers were changed to 07. Warning went out for businesses in 98. So anyone with half a brain would have not had signs made after 98 with 04 for the mobile number, which says to me it opened in 97. Logic dictates. It was closed in 2012. What kind of parent chooses to take their toddler onto the grounds of a pedo palace and leave them there, day in, day out? Who in their right mind even thinks, oh, well, okay, it used to be a pedo-like place, but I'll take my kid there now. It just doesn't make sense to me. You know, if somebody can explain it, then please. In 1992, Adrian Johns died in a fire in Brighton. That property was owned by Nicholas Van Hoogenstraten. Van Hoogenstraten is known for his business empire as well as his controversial life story. In 68, he was convicted and sent to prison for paying a gang to attack a business associate. In 2002, he was sentenced to 10 years for manslaughter of a business rival. The verdict was overturned on appeal, and he was subsequently released. In 2005, he was ordered to pay the victim's family £6 million in a civil case. It's estimated to be worth over £500 million. Although he claims his assets in the UK have all been placed in the names of his children. How convenient. Can I be adopted by him, please? I need a new daddy. Sugar one. In 1995, most of the children's records being transported from the inquiry team in North Wales to the courts were destroyed in a fire in a Pickford's furniture packing and shipping warehouse in Chester. Now, I'm sorry, who in their right mind puts confidential records of children, hundreds of vulnerable children, in a Pickford's packing and furniture packing and shipping warehouse? You just don't do it, do you? You know? You don't know who the fuck's going to be walking through the door, rooting through the boxes, looking for a pair of fucking mucky underwear in whatever the shipping. You know? But it burnt down. Three times in the past 25 years, the warehouse has burnt down. It is still owned and operated by Pickford's. Coincidence? I think not. But who am I to judge? Now, when John Allen was finally paid off in the 90s, prior to his arrest, his settlement from Ken White Sr. was valued at over £500,000. His personal loans and business loans, provided by Ken White Sr., amounting to £210,000, were wiped out. He got company car released, £10,000. Company had released its interest in a Brighton property, not the one where the fire happened, a villa in Bordeaux, and yacht number two, £200,000 value, and a cottage in Gloucestershire, £80,000, and then £36,000 in cash for the return of all company shares. Now, I'm sorry, this was a paedophile who had been acquiring all these properties for the company. Why was he getting so much money when they were looking to bring him inside? Why was he getting access to the yacht, number two? Why did they have two yachts in the first place? What kind of kid's home needs two yachts? You know, I never saw a yacht. I was there for over a year. Apparently all the boys did, but I never did. Where was my fucking sailing trip, bastards? Now, over the years, they acquired several properties. There was Brynallen Hall, which was set in 50 acres of land. Gwasted Hall, where John Allen himself lived. Pentrosyson Hall, which is now owned by Prospects for Young Children, which is coincidentally run by one of the directors of Brynallen Community, Stephen Elliott. Property Gatewin Hall, which was Georgian three-story building, which is the place I was placed. That was a bastard to jump out of window. I can tell you that one now. You know, I might have done it out at fucking second floor in Skirkup Lodge. No way was I going out at third floor. Bryn Tirion Hall. Property in Trevor Street in Hightown in Wrexham. Property in Poyser Street, which they used as a film studio. They set up three film companies over the course of several years. One of which went bust overnight and lost £125,000, which was unaccountable. Literally overnight. Oops. I wish I'd got a pony that year. Somebody else did, I know that much. A property in Erdig Road, which was used as halfway house. A property in Queens Road, Wursel. Nice little three-bedroom semi-detached. It's where they stuck me and my son after I'd had him. Martin's Camp in Shropshire. Cotsbrook Hall, just down the road in Shifnal. And then, and this one, you're going to love this one. 34 Inverness Terrace in Bayswater. Straight across the road from Richard Branson. Who the fuck wants to put a kid's home in Bayswater? Who the fuck wants to live right across the road from a bunch of delinquent kids? I fucking wouldn't. And I was one of them. No way would I have had that on my street or any street that I went near. Because, I'm sorry, I went near the street, so I knew what a bastard I was. And then there was the village in Bordeaux, the cottage in Gloucestershire, the two yachts, and several properties in Brighton connected to Van Hoogenstraten. Sorry, my voice is going. In the 70s, Brynallen Community established with Ken White Sr. as financial backer and David Evans as secretary. Well, we all know those ones. You know, the personal assistant rather than the typing pool. Dr. Kedney and Dr. Roberts had their own private medical practice around the corner from Brynallen Hall. And there was Dr. Kedney was set on as medical officer for Brynallen Community. Every time a girl went, even with a headache, she had to have an internal. Dr. Kedney was last seen running a strip joint in Athens. His business partner retired 2 years ago. From the same surgery, just round the corner from Poyser Street, where they'd always been. And he was, at that point, denying all knowledge of Dr. Kedney, even though it was both names on the practice when they opened it. In the 80s, Ken White Jr. and David Evans were accused of physical and indecent assault, but both agreed to take non-residential care positions to avoid investigation. And Waterhouse actually agreed with that decision and agreed there would be no investigation into the allegations against them if they stayed on off residential care. Except in 91, when I was in Brynallen Hall, I remember Ken White Jr. being the head of the home at one point. Yeah, that's by 91 he was back in residential child care. So what the fuck? In the 80s, Lynn Williams, who had been deputy of Gateman Hall, was accused of indecent assault against a couple of lads in a different home. In the 80s and 90s, Stephen Elliott, as I mentioned, Prospects for Young People, and Ken White Jr. were made directors of Brynallen Hall Brynarwen community, and the other 16 subsidiary companies that they ended up opening and then closing and laundering money through. Most of them don't even reflect on Company's House anymore because it's all been deleted. Company's House have a habit of allowing companies through without a valid company number. There are dozens of directors involved in residential childcare who hold four or five different director numbers. Now, I thought that was illegal. You know, company has a different one, but your director doesn't. Your director number is meant to stay with you, isn't it? I thought. Somebody tell me if I'm wrong. Okay, I'm not then. Right. Now, in the 90s, medical records started to vanish for the residents of Brynarwen Hall and Brynarwen community. Starting with the girls of Gatewen Hall, there were 5 pregnancies in the space of 1 year. 4 girls, 5 pregnancies. When the girl who had been pregnant second time found out she was pregnant, we were told the next morning as we went down to breakfast that she had gone back to her pimp in Birmingham. She'd been sold to her pimp by a family member when she was 9. She'd escaped him twice, and the third time she escaped, she'd been told, if you ever leave me again, I will see you dead. So I didn't believe that she'd gone back there. And I'm sorry, in 91, from Wrexham to Birmingham, there is no way by breakfast, in my mind, that they could have known where she had gone. And if they did, why didn't they go and get her back? Yeah, she lived with no shoes, no coat, no money. She took nothing apart from what she was supposedly wearing when we went to bed, which was her nightie. It was in the middle of fucking February. I'm sorry, it was fucking cold, mate. There's no way I'd be going from Wrexham to Birmingham in me fucking nightie. I wouldn't do it in the middle of summer. As we were being told this, groundwork started outside the dining room to lay the foundation for an aviary for quail. I'm sorry, quail legs, have you seen the size of them? They don't do fucking jack shit, mate. You know, you might as well just fucking use them as ammo. But we were told she'd gone back to her pimp in Birmingham. Who knows? The girl has never been traced, there's never been a death record for her, and I was told she died a year later from a drug overdose. Now, Ken White, he obviously carried on in residential childcare, and then after his dad died, he actually inherited Brynarwen Hall, even though it was meant to have been sold off for the compensation pot, along with all the other homes. Ken White Sr. had already taken Petrus Eisen as his pension. In lieu of 3 years' pension, he took a whole operating children's home away from the company that was meant to be running it and put it back under his name in lieu of pension. What the fuck? I'm sorry, how can you take a whole children's home that's part of a community under stipulated social services rules, yeah, and say, okay, it doesn't belong to them anymore, it belongs to me, without anything put in place to safeguard those children, or the company, or the home? It just doesn't work. And this, Brynarwen Hall, is where Ken White is currently living. He still lives there with his wife. At the moment, it operates as an hotel. Still with the 50 acres of land. Now, when I was first down there a couple of years ago to have a look over the place, it had 15 very nice, very expensive horses on the property. The last time I went down, there were 2 musty old nags that looked like they should have been in glue factory 2 years ago. No nice mounts. Now, prospects for young children offer horse riding as part of their curriculum. Funny that, isn't it? With their mates still running like somewhere with 15 nice thoroughbreds. And yes, some of them were thorough. Now, one of the other directors of Bryn Allen Hall, David Russell Evans, he, with Ken White Jr., operates sort of about 16 companies out of Bryn Allen Hall. Most of them don't seem to make any money. In fact, most of them are actually in debt. But somehow they've got old people's homes, they've got children's homes, they've got an MOT service station, all operating. And they've had the service station for 25 years. Funnily enough, Prospects for Young Children offers mechanics on its curriculum as well. You know, I personally don't find this a coincidence. I find it fucking highly suspicious. And anyone else should as well, to be fair. And if you don't, then tell me I'm wrong. Now, he still lives in the lodge, as I said. He's director of God knows how many companies. God knows where the horses have gone. Now, when I went back there a couple of years ago, this was the last house, the last building that hadn't been renovated. As I was walking around it with my mum, we saw through the window a load of files. Now, as you can see, well, actually you can't because it's a bit dark, there are cobwebs all over the files, all over the window. They look a good inch thick. Those files have not been touched since the place shut down in 97. Now, as we walked further around the property, we saw this. A bonfire that had already been burnt and was being rebuilt with all the paperwork and all the crap coming out of that last building. So I rang Operation Palial and said, look, there's evidence in there. There's potential evidence in that building that they are setting fire to. Oh, but we went through all that years ago. There couldn't be nothing there. Well, there could be a start of a letter home from any child in one of those books, in one of those files, saying, look, Mum, they're doing this to me. Come and get me. Come and save me. Help. But they wouldn't go and look, and they let them destroy it all. I wasn't looking. I was looking.
We have a massive round of applause.
Yeah, yeah, please.